Hello everybody, I'm Colin Baker, the Sixth Doctor, and you are so lucky, because you are watching the Amiga Files, and I'm in it at the moment, but the next bit isn't me, it's something even better.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Omega Files. I'm your host, Dr. Freedom, and tonight we've gathered to have a little discussion about the Series 9 finale, The Event, a.k.a. Clara Who. Okay, let's go ahead and let's get everybody introed. Let's start with Philip.
Good evening and welcome.
Callan.
Hello.
Okay, Andrew.
Hello.
Edgar.
Hello there.
Floyd.
Hey, hey.
AJ.
Hello.
Graham.
I know a place you can get some cracking lemonade.
Beef Ed.
There's an old prophecy when Beef shows up with a drink in his hand.
Okay, William.
Hey, now, how you doing, everybody?
Oh, man, shows up with a drink in his hand. Oh. Kevin.
Hello, I just barely started.
Woo! Okay, Bill.
Hello. So for all of you out there in YouTube land, there's a cat in this video, so like and subscribe.
Okay, Texas Tim.
Hello there.
Matt Rose.
Oh, hello, good evening from the other side of Gallifrey.
And Anthony.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, so very, very interesting episode, because the first thing that struck me as I was sitting here watching this, it kind of reminded me the first, like, say, 15, 20 minutes of it as like one of the old Clint Eastwood Man with No Name movies, you know, where the guy just walks into town and then basically takes over. It was just, you know, I love that bit there where the doctor literally says nothing for almost 10 minutes after the beginning titles roll. And, you know, the way he just lays down the law and he doesn't even have to say a word. I love that. But, okay, let's get your guys' opening thoughts on it. We'll start at the bottom. Let's start with Anthony.
I thought it was this is going to be a shock. I thought it was an actual fairly good episode. I did enjoy the line in the sand and a couple of the one-liners from the general before regeneration. And the the end of it. It leaves it wide open for the return of me and Clara.
All right, Matt Rose. Matt, I think he froze up.
Oh, no.
But he looks so picturesque there.
Man, he pays Bill.
Okay, Texas Tim.
I thought it was great. It tied up all the arcs of the series and left things with a clean slate, so it can move on, you know, to Christmas, and then who knows where from there.
Okay, you back with us, Matt? Okay. Go ahead, Matt. Matt.
Must be that new technology he has.
Sorry.
Go ahead, Matt.
I'm using a Kindle at the minute, so I have a lot of issues. Sorry. Really enjoyed the finale very much. It was so great to be back on Gallifrey at long last. And, yes, it was great to see the Time Lords yet again. Yeah, trapping him in his own confession dial last week, this week, just to try and get some information on the hybrid and everything. Pushing him to the brink
of freezing.
Not paying an internet service.
It's the way of the future. I think Matt's facing the Raven.
The laptop certainly is.
We'll get back to you, Matt. Vil.
Yes.
Opening thoughts.
And, well,
I guess that for the opening thoughts, I'll go with the, I don't know, opening of the episode that seems to make the most sense. I thought that that little insurrection was outright comical. When he told Davros to get off of his, or Davros, he told Rassilon to get off of his planet like it was his lawn, the only thing missing was the shotgun.
Okay, Matt, try again.
And he's...
Yeah, he's done.
Why do I feel like I'm watching that old movie, Buell?
Still working now. With the camera on this evening.
Okay, go on. Yeah, go on ahead with the camera off. You're fine.
Let me try it again. Yes, I've been enjoying Hellbent very much this evening. It's just a very great end to a three-part trilogy. Very much enjoyed Capaldi, as usual. Rachel Talalay did a very good job at directing him this year. She's been a great job for directing finales. She should be on the payroll more for this stuff. I'm also very glad we got introduced to these sliders, but there is room for development more on them. We know they come from the Cloister Wars, but I'd like to have learned a little bit more about them. Rassilon, great that he come back in the new body. That last time we saw him, it was Timothy Dalton. But yes, to see Donald Sumter take on the new version was great, but he was just defeated way too easy. He just got off Gallifrey, just set down easy. Hopefully that's left for room for him to come back another time. Enjoyable finale, and yes, this is definitely now, it's definitely the end of Clara. If she comes back again, it'll be just way too soon. Even though it is time travel, the universe is big and all. They're bound to, he can't not help running into her, but I don't think they'll explore that on screen anyway, probably in an off-screen adventure. All in all, it's just been a big epic finale. Each part of the series has told a story leading back to when it started with Missy and Davros back at the start of this run to when we first met Ashilda to now here at the end of Clara's journey. It's, again, the only things that were really undeveloped for me was the sliders.
Okay, sliders. Kevin!
Don't shout at me! I was just relaxing. I loved it.
Fledged story on a bit.
It's still gone,
though. We got a bit of delay here in Fanland. well. Let me try again. I loved it. I loved Clara, the beginning with the diner, Peter Capaldi coming with his guitar, has no remember, you know, of Clara. That was very interesting to see. Rassilon was just kicked off his planet, like the doctor just came on his planet like, go away, you. You know what I mean. But, yeah, Rassilon was just chopped off his planet. And, the general regenerated into a woman, a black woman, so that was very interesting to see. The story itself was very good. And I really liked it. And yes. Then the Christmas trailer. So yeah, that was good.
Well, we're going to talk about that later. So.
All right. 10 out of 10. I'm already going to give it.
Okay, William.
This is the season finale. And we get to see the Clara does show up in this episode. But like I said, in the ending of the episode, she will go back to where she died for the universe of to pay a price for that. It is that, you know, she's just taking a long trip with Ashilda. Now, whether they're going to end up ever showing them again, it really doesn't make a difference. because this show is about the Doctor. But you know, if they could come back in Big Finish, that'd be nice. But the cool thing is that when he went back home, nobody ever was against the Doctor, except of course for the president. But he find out the hallway that nobody's gonna listen to him anymore. But just like this lady from Khan told the president, everybody knows that he's the one that started the war. So that's why they have more respect for the Doctor than him. That's why he told him to get off the planet. It was weird. The only thing that was weird is that is to see how far the Doctor was willing to go to get Clara back. You know, and those of us who listen to Big Finish know that you can say by accident or by chance he'd done it before, taking somebody from who supposedly had died at a fixed point. And but the thing is, the Time Lords took care of that. You know, they fixed that. So I was a little bit nervous that I thought maybe they was gonna do something like that again, just like put a double or something in her spot and let her continue living her own way. You know, the Doctor getting his memory erased, I think that was the right call for him to forget about her and continue on his own life, so to speak. So hopefully, we know who's gonna appear in the Christmas episode like that. So hopefully, we could, in a few months, we get to find out who the new companion is and what stories are gonna come off of next season, you know, to continue his journey.
Okay, Beefhead.
It's been an interesting one. I know that this is gonna, divide opinion as some things generally do. What's been different, I would say, probably about the end of this season is that the two final episodes have been character-driven pieces. Instead of it being an immediate threat, this one principally has been him dealing with change and loss. So, that was certainly different. I completely agree with you. The opening 20 minutes was superb. I love the procession of people and everything like that. And, they turned around to the president and said, no, he hasn't got a problem with anyone else. The only person he's got a problem with is you. That was superb. The scene with him just stepping out in front of the ship, staring down the gun and everything like that. Drop your weapons. And he puts down the spoon because the only weapon he does need, we know from previous episodes, is a spoon. So that was good. There were nice little touches, nice dialogue harked back. There were some very quotable lines in it and echoes of things gone past. In essence, it was a current finale. Are people going to feel shortchanged by it? Some people possibly will. It is going to be a mixed bag, and it's whatever going to be float your boat. I would say for the overall, I enjoyed it. I sort of struggled for a while because I think I watched it back at least twice for a second viewing now, struggling to see where I fell on it. Did I really enjoy it, or did I just sort of feel unsure about it? I walked away with it feeling satisfied, but not like, oh my God, there was no, I think apart from perhaps the little bit at the end where he snaps the fingers and, assumes the mantle. That's the, oh yes. And the Sonic, obviously that's the, oh yes part for me. That was the big wow for it. But Tim made a very good point. It sort of draws a line. It closes that chapter and leaves things to start afresh with a new companion in the next season. So from that point of view, it was well done.
Okay. Graham.
I've got to echo a lot of what Beef said. Really enjoyed this. The music. I love the music in this. The score was excellent. As you guys have echoed, the first 20 minutes, with Clint Eastwood roaming into town, doesn't even utter a word. Phenomenal expressions within that 10-15 minute exchange where he has to convey, obviously, with gestures and his looks. The resolution to Clara, right, okay, cards on the table, people have been miffed that she's no technically still, dead by the rolling of the credits, but I kind of like the way they resolved it. You had a role reversal of the Donna thing, whereby it's him who's forgot this time. And as Beefhead alluded to, the book is now closed on Clara Oswald, and we're off to the races after Christmas with a new companion. Bring it on. Satisfactory close to the season.
Okay. AJ.
I really enjoyed the episode. I thought it was quite well constructed and paced. The whole thing with being back on Gallifrey, brilliant. I like the way he sort of almost looked Amish in what he was wearing with the collar and the vest, and everyone else around him sort of looked Amish as well. The whole thing with Rassilon, that was could have been handled better. Maybe they should have locked him back in his tomb again in the Dark Tower, left him there to rot, instead of kicking him off the planet, giving him a chance to get his revenge. But other than that, brilliant story.
He got loose. He's going to come back later in Black Wrestling, you see. That's how that works, remember? For Big Finish audience. Okay. All right. Floyd.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this episode. I do think I preferred last week, but I really like that we're back on Gallifrey. I find it a little odd, and maybe you guys on the panel there can sort of help me out here. Gallifrey wasn't in a pocket universe in this episode. It was just at the end of Hours?
Yeah.
Right, okay. Interesting. I always thought that the 8th anniversary, was meant to have put them in a pocket universe. Did they explain how they got out? That's the only thing I didn't quite follow in the story was how did they get out of the pocket?
My only assumption is the Time Lords figured their own way out.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, other than that, I really liked this episode. I top marks for me, definitely.
Okay, Edgar.
Okay, well, I guess I'm the mixed bag because I did not like this episode. I liked both the previous parts to this three-part finale, but this one just went, the first 20 minutes, really good, the whole standoff. I do think they got rid of Rassilon way too easily, but I don't know. I think bringing Clara back in the way they did, keeping her with the, you know, the one pulse or whatever it is, it cheated her out of her death. She did something stupid and faced the Raven, and she died a noble death. She had to face up to it. And this kind of, I feel cheated by that. I mean, the other thing is, in the end, when they kind of reverse the thing that was done with Donna. Okay, so he's lost all his memories, and then all of a sudden, just by talking to Clara, who he didn't even really know was Clara, he gets all his memories back, and he just shows up at his TARDIS, and all of a sudden, boom, he's the Doctor again. I don't know. To me, this episode was just really...
He only lost his memories of her.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I guess that makes a little more sense, but to me, it just... I don't know. I really didn't care for this episode. It's just... It didn't do it for me. It's probably since I started watching the show, and I've watched all of New Who, and I've watched a lot of the classic Who, probably the worst season finale / series finale that I've seen. It just did not do it for me.
Okay, wow. What about you, Andrew?
I liked the episode. It was nice how they got Clara out, and hopefully get a new companion next year. Looking forward to Christmas.
All right, Kellen.
Yeah, I'm with Edgar on this one. I didn't really like it, especially the start was very slow. They're going to cut out some of that. Instead of three groups of people turning up, they've got to do the two. It got better towards the end. Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't too bad. Could have done that a wee bit more pacing. Anyway.
Okay, and Philip.
Well, do you know what? I like it. Overall, I like the entire story. I do have a problem with one thing with Rassilon. This Time Lord is meant to be the founder of Gallifrey, and he's supposed to be the big bad Time Lord that no one faces down. And yet, all Doctor does is say, get off my planet, and he walks off meekly. I didn't like that resolution about Rassilon. There should have been a bit more to Rassilon than that. It was too easy. I do like... It was fantastic.
That tells you right there that he has been so political for so many years, he no longer has the influential power that he had way back then. That's why the Doctor was able to face him, and everybody that was in the military stood up to him too to tell him to get off.
True, but when you look at the history of Rassilon through other media, he's a lot more gung-ho.
But you got to remember, you listen to the audience also. A lot of the legends that you hear of Rassilon are so, you remember, some of them are based on other people that he's credited for.
True, fair enough. So, I still say it was a weak way of facing him down anyway. It should have been a bit more Titanic than that. Well, but anyway.
But you know, the episode would have to run more than it did today for them, you know, to show more of him like that.
That basically, that whole time the doctor was trapped, they just sat around on their butts and waited. So this is literally 4.5 billion years later. Gallifrey's only got another 500 million years to exist at all. So Rassilon at that point is basically a pointless figurehead of a pointless people.
Okay, before we get off to the races, though, joining us late, Ryan, I want to get your opening thoughts on the episode before we open up the floor.
I thought it was a really good story. Not quite as good as last week, but I thought Gallifrey looked really cool. The way they presented the Time Lords, that they, well, at least from the soldiers' point of view, they viewed the Doctor as a war hero and were willing to stand against Rassilon to just show how much the Doctor meant to them. The whole kind of Clara thing, I wasn't disappointed that she lived in the end. I thought they actually took a really unique spin on it. So that's like the second time that they've proved me wrong, because I wasn't initially fond of Osgood living. But yeah, they proved me wrong twice in the same season.
Okay, let's open up the floor. I love that. I haven't even started. Tell the High Council they're on the next shuttle.
Well, that kind of Time Lords were made out to that made out to be pretty much bumbling idiots again. Kind of like how they were in the Deadly Assassin. I mean, he's walking circles around them the whole time, and they're just trying to catch up with him. And it's just cool that for 2 years now he's been trying to find these guys, and now he couldn't possibly care less. I mean, it's done and dusted as far as he's concerned, Gallifrey, I guess.
I've got to say, I love the scene in the other TARDIS, you know, they bring her back. What was it? Something along the lines of, you know, I'm sorry for breaking your jaw. What, you apologize to me? No, you, turn around, bang.
Sort of like a Space Glasgow, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, a Space Glasgow, yeah.
What I found interesting is when he was speaking to Clara in the Under Catacombs, he was mentioning about Susan. Basically saying he stole the prisoner's daughter. I'm like, oh! So Susan was of high ranking class.
Maybe they didn't mention her by name.
No. The rumor was somebody kidnapped the prisoner's wife and stole the moon. Fell in love with her, but then the doctor say, no. He fell in love with the prisoner's daughter.
And then, that wasn't Susan then.
No, it wasn't Susan.
That was Susan's mother.
Susan's grandmother.
Grandmother, yeah.
Yeah.
Her grandmother, you're right. Sorry, I always get that mixed up.
Tennessee, in which case it could be both the mother and the grandmother.
Oh, yeah. go on ahead, Beef. You want to bring up something?
No, yeah, I was going to say, I mean, one thing it did do very effectively, I would say, in the first 20 minutes, certainly with regards to the council and the president, is that I think they've done it before, but this basically cemented it. It got away from the romanticising of the Time Lords and everything like that. Basically, he came across as a complete bastard for everyone to see. You know, I like the fact that just when he looked down to him and said, yeah, you're out here in the dust and sand, but do you know what that means for me? No witnesses. And, you know, that completely just sealed his character. So I did like that. The romanticising of, you know, the High Council and everything like that, that has completely gone now. Yeah, they are politico scumbags. Ripe for toppling.
I've got to say, though, I love the fact that Ohelia and her crew just barged in there as if it was nothing. We're here. What are you going to do about it? You know?
Kind of just turn up at the end of time like it's nothing.
Yeah, that confused me. I didn't understand that. How could
they? Whatever the hell they like.
That's why we know that TARDIS technology. So fucking them.
Yeah, how did they travel all the way from Khan to there? That's just like, didn't make sense.
Well, you got to remember that. Are we talking about, you know, how did Gallifrey wind up at the end of time?
No. How did
Khan come up the other end of time?
Yeah, how did the Sisterhood get there? Because they don't have TARDIS technology, and so.
Oh, the Sisterhood?
Yeah, remember, Gallifrey's not in the exact same spot where he was. It's somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got to remember, the Sisterhood have some pretty darn amazing powers. That was established. No, that was established in Big Finish.
Yep. Not only that, remember how they teleported the Doctor's body in the brain of Morbius?
But you can do that. You can do that over a short distance, but not billions of time and billions of years. Down the line.
Sisterhood of the Flame, wasn't it? Were they
Sisters of the Flame. Go back and listen to that, Philip.
No, yeah. But you misunderstand. That must take a... You're talking about Gallifrey.
I said last night you'd have this problem, wouldn't it?
Nah, I know.
From Karn or San Francisco?
I'm confused, though, because I thought that the end of the universe was the year 1 trillion in...
100 trillion.
So before the Sound of Drums, where he meets... what's his name? Christiana.
Yeah, I don't know why they're
using billions of trillions, and there you go.
Yeah, I don't know why they used 4.5 billion years, you know, basically the age of the Earth, and then they doubled it and said that's when the universe is going to end. I don't know why they went that route either.
Yeah.
The other problem is they've basically now established that the Doctor's present, and basically Gallifrey's present, because you know how that works for the Time Lords, is basically darn near the end of everything.
Well, they can move around probably if they wanted to. It's not too hard for them.
Yeah, they said they located the planet there, wasn't it? So I would guess that they have the option now to move it if they can take it out of the pocket universe.
But they also made it sound like while the Doctor is in the confession dial, time went the same way for them, which makes all of the Time Lords, the Gallifreyans who aren't Time Lords, ancient, and it also kind of paints them into a corner.
I don't think that he was literally in the time in the confession dial for that long. I think that was just how it felt for him.
Unless the passage of time inside the confession dial is different to outside.
Yeah, to extend the time.
It's outside of time, so the passage of time inside there is different to the outside of it.
Yeah, the confession dial philosophy, the confession dial was still in Earth when the Doctor was looking up at the stars, just when anybody got confused last week. Okay, it was only a light year away from its original space, which means it's still pretty much in the Earth's solar system.
Yeah. And
it's 3-point-something light years to the nearest star, which is Alpha Centauri, for people that are pedantic, like me. I hate you, that big guy. Alpha Centauri, yeah.
Check out the Scottish Stephen Hawking, Jesus.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Many subtitles, yeah.
I know what I would have liked. I would have liked to see the Doctor in Time Lord Garb. That would be nice to see.
Fuck away.
Why?
No, it would be nice.
It's not a fashion show.
Yeah, not
no, but, no, but the only other time we ever saw him wear that is the Assassin. I would have liked to see him just put one on just for...
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right, hold on. AJ's got his hand up. Go ahead, AJ.
Yeah, I was going to say, I would like to have seen the Doctor take on Russell as the president, because technically the Doctor was never deposed as president.
I think he might have been.
I think he was, yeah. Yeah, what episode was that?
Yeah, he was out.
Trial comes up in Trial of a Time Lord. Yeah,
yeah, that's the one, yeah.
Oh, okay.
This means that he's now been president 3 times.
Why not? Doctor, they don't have turbo.
I like the twist, though. I like how that they lead you down thinking that, okay, she's going to lose her memory. They're going to do what they did with Donna. Then he's going to just transplant her in Utah somewhere as a waitress, like where we see at the beginning. But then they twist the whole thing around where he actually loses his memory of her, which is good because that means that Christmas, he's not going to be, chilling out, all lonely on a cloud like he was when he lost his other best friends last time. He's going to be, on the go.
Doctor.
Clean slate, just ready to go. Got a new
The only cafe with a quantum toilet. Yeah,
there you go.
Apparently, for those it matters to, apparently the glasses are gone too because I think he left them with her, and now he's got a brand new Sonic. So,
thank God,
hurry to bring back the candy.
Really?
The candy man. Well, there you go. Yeah,
that diner TARDIS might spit him out.
Can I put in something here?
Go ahead. And
what I thought would what everybody's kind of bypassing over that kind of caught my attention was Hela's comment, "Boy, get out here and talk to me to my face."
Oh yeah.
You know what did she mean by, you know, how much of a relationship did she have prior than we've seen her in the previous episode with the doctor? Makes me wonder now.
Well, it was pretty much established anyway at the start of the season, wasn't it? That they've had a very long-standing relationship. That she's some sort of, I don't know, counselor to him or some sort of
friend,
confidant. Yeah, do you know what I mean? Yeah. Very long-standing relationship. But yeah, I get the idea of the boy thing. To be honest with you, who knows? She could have been some sort of therapist because was it when on all accounts that when he was there, you know, he was there for, was it 4 weeks or 4 days? I can't remember, was it 4 weeks, something like that? When he came out, he was a changed person, but he was a very young lad and everything like that.
Yeah.
Who knows? She could have been some form of, you know, Time Lord therapist for all we know.
Yeah.
She could have been the Time Lord Harley Quinn in the younger days, you know.
Oh, yeah. Dr. Bong, yeah.
Dr. Bong, yeah.
And who was the old lady that never said anything? It always looked like she was about to
That was the custodian of the young Time Lord children before they go into the academy.
The woman, yeah.
Yeah,
because really she never got a word in.
Oh, was that a Gallifreyan summer camp? Jesus.
Basically, yeah.
The accommodation's crap, yeah. Hmm.
And did that, or did it not? You know, that original console room, you know, they finally used it. It looked brilliant in this episode, didn't it?
Oh, yeah. Man. I was weeing myself with happiness. It was cool.
Stop, really?
Oh, really?
It looked even better. It looked
when
even
aren't better. You?
It had more of a three-dimensional quality to it.
Yeah, like that's right. That's right. Or,
But also the doors, getting in the TARDIS were too small. They weren't the right height and size.
Yeah, I suppose.
I like the writer as well. The writer was quite good. Yeah. It had its own sort of like internal moving parts and everything like that. It was just a lovely little balance as well.
When I saw it,
I got a little bit of wood.
it was good. It was nice to spot the fault locator area off to the side. That was nice to see. I do that as well.
When I first saw the trailer and saw the old TARDIS in it, I'm thinking, really, they're going there? Won't it look a little? But it looked completely fine.
I just looked up Utopia, and the universe was meant to end in the year 100 trillion.
Yeah.
So they're going to have a hard time explaining that one.
Wibbly wobbly.
Cracks in time.
That's just writer.
Yeah, that's more like Gallifreyan smoking crack in time.
They explain a lot.
Apparently, Rassilon's lost the ability to just disintegrate people.
Yeah. Wow, it waits too long.
If he's going to do it, think about it. He's got a whole planet that basically just gave him the middle finger. Killing the doctor ain't going
to
get wiped out.
How did Gallifrey get out of there? He basically left as soon as Gallifrey. They don't say anything to spell it out. It's just kind of what you can put together saying it.
Yeah,
you get the impression of his own paranoia, though, don't you? That he, in essence, is obsessed about what could be the one potential threat to his power, which is the hybrid. So you get the idea that if he's willing to make the confession dial a torture chamber, he's willing to let it run for that amount of time, his paranoia is at an all-time high, so to speak.
Well, considering he was, you know, he was the main push for the final sanction, he's batshit crazy.
The doctor showing up as he did is the last thing he wants to see, really. He thought that the confession
was his hand.
Now it's forced his hand. I like how the hybrid ends up being nothing.
In my opinion, it doesn't exist. But the funny, I like the shield that was saying, you know, that for a time, though, you should come on Earth. Are you sure you're not the hybrid yourself?
Yeah, that's the point.
I left that money gag from you know where.
Well, yeah, it's putting the weight, putting the value to the prophecy. So it's sort of like, okay, well, you know, he's going to be a combination of two warrior races. Well, what color is he?
Yeah, there you go. Yeah,
yeah, it puts a lot of truck in. Yeah, everything.
Yeah. I mean, they showed the Time Lords up to be the stupid people they are, really. I mean, look at them. They're so worried about something that doesn't really even exist. It's just two friends hanging out, and they're calling it a hybrid.
Mm. So.
Well, the Time Lord's been around so long. Once they get one idea stuck in their head, it seems like they can't let it go until it's resolved. So, you know, they're just like fixed points in time. They get a fixed point of idea in their mind and, you know, terrifies the hell out of them. When Rassilon lost the backing of the military, he knew it was over. So lose all your lives or get the f*** out of here and maybe get revenge later.
But you know what? If the Matrix is all-powerful and all-knowing, right, shouldn't it have known what the hybrid is or who it is? And if it, and
it's not really all-knowing. Basically, the what is it, the last, or the thoughts of the dead or whatever?
It's a database of uploaded things, and in essence, it's a predictive. It's like the idea, you know, say, right, Minority Report. It's like precog, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And, you know, they predictive, and that's why you get the cloister bell and everything like that. That one thing I did like as well, very much from the start of the episode, all the bells are going off as soon as the yeah, that's a 5-bell alarm for everyone.
Before they explained the cloister wraiths to the extent that they did, when I first saw them, you know, the face shifting underneath the cowl, did anyone here actually read Engines of War?
Yeah.
I expected that these were going to be kind of like what happened to Barusa.
Yeah.
But remember, Barusa was in the Dom. He was in
the Dom.
Well, you have to remember that there were others. Barusa was just the most successful version. So there's definitely room for the cloister wraiths to offend us.
They didn't really do a whole lot, those slider things.
You know, nobody went to face them. That's why they're not stupid to go face them.
Yeah.
But it seems they've all got little segues. So
yeah.
Endorsing the must-have toy this Christmas.
Yeah, and get it blowed up underneath your feet. Bang.
I have to agree with William's idea there that the hybrid never actually existed ever. Mm. I think there's a lot of gravitas to that, and I do think that line where he's like, "I ran away from myself," it was definitely making fun of the TV movie. It's quite good. I thought that was quite good.
Oh, yeah, there was definitely that nod to it, isn't it? For someone who's from Gallifrey and everything like that, that you spend a lot of time hanging out on Earth, why is this? Yeah.
But I thought they neither confirmed or denied it. You know,
yeah, that's it. Yeah, they didn't do that. That was definitely...
Yeah, they implied it, but they didn't actually say it, did they? That's
right. Yeah. No, and they've already kind of joked out the stupid whole he's half-human thing. When the Doctor has said that a half-human Time Lord can't happen.
Yeah.
No. I do wonder, but I think they've done so many things this season, certainly, even in this episode, just to leave it open to people just to bitch and moan.
Oh, to be fair, they didn't have to do that. They'd have bitched and moaned anyway, you know.
Well, yeah, I know, but it's just like, you know, we'll give them a little bit of string to pull on and see if they can take the whole sweater.
Yeah, yeah.
In terms of the fact that a half Time Lord, half human can't exist, that's just coming from the two-way biological meta crisis. That's not like a actual, like, if a Time Lord banged a human.
Wow.
Yeah. You have to make it really crude, don't you? Jesus.
The meta crisis, Doctor.
A human cannot carry a Time Lord consciousness.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the meta crisis Doctor is actually super surprised that he's half human as well. I think Russell already retconned it with that line. He was just like, "I'm half human. What? This is weird."
Yeah, one heart. Oh, what?
Yeah.
Plus, you got to remember, he was cursed with all Adonis traits. That poor fella.
Yeah.
If we ever see him again, he's going to be on an exercise bike, and he's going to have a
tape off. We already did see him. He came back to Earth. He started wearing purple suits. And he started telling people what to do.
And licking faces.
Jessica Jones, I got that.
It's not because of like an affection on him. It's just because he's David Tennant and he can do that.
Right. Well, what people's faces? I don't need to wave a bit too hard.
Are we happy that Moffat decided yet again to showcase a Time Lord regenerating to a woman again this time around?
It doesn't bother me. I don't get the big deal.
It's different.
Death is a term for man flu on Gallifrey. Regeneration in room two. Oh, right, okay, he's not a dude, he's now a black chick. He's like, why should it bother any of us?
The only reason Phil's a wee bit upset, and I take it our buddy on the other cast with the same as well, if he perceives it as a massive FU. Well, maybe that's don't bitch
about how is it FU after last year when you turned the...
But what I'm saying is...
It's an FU because you never saw last year, that's why.
Well, you see, Moffat may have already painted himself into a corner because just wait, some stupid social justice warrior is going to see the same episode, and you know what they're going to take out of the regeneration into a female? They're going to say that it's somehow slandering trans people. And it's
they will totally do that.
Something like this. They're going to make it an all-out assault on a group of people that was never intended, and it's going to become retarded drama. Just wait.
All right. DeVille, if the Mirror runs with that article this week, I'm blaming you.
I'd like to go back to the...
He's already freaking out over Jessica Jones for some stupid reason, which I'd know if I bothered to pay attention to her rants.
Besides, I don't know why people are freaking out anyway. Michael Jackson was proof that a young black man can grow up to be a rich old white woman.
There you go. Oh,
I always believed that Michael Jackson and Janet Jackson were the same person.
I thought that was a whole other thing. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Anthony? I'd like to go back to that conversation between the general and Rassilon when Rassilon goes, "Who the hell does he think he is?" And the general goes, "He's the one that ended the time war."
No, he survived.
That was priceless.
He's the one that won the time war.
That was such a beautiful bitch slap to Rassilon.
Yeah, I mean, what was that line? You get the John Hurt reference when the Doctor of War stands before you. The first thing you see, he bears no arms or something.
Yep.
He's unarmed.
And that's the last thing that you see.
Yeah.
But I love that scene, though, where they got the big, bad, evil, mechanized machine, and he starts walking forward, and it starts edging backwards.
It's backing up. I like when he draws that line, and nobody steps over it. Not even Rassilon steps over it. The only time somebody steps over it when they drop their gun, they go behind them. Not against them, they go behind them.
Yeah, the funniest line I thought was though when he goes, "On pain of death, nobody take a selfie."
Yeah. That was funny. But the thing I found interesting is the bit where he's just about to shoot Ken Bond as a general. Was like, "Regeneration number 10. Oh, that's all right. You've got a few left. Bang."
Yeah.
I hope it works out for you.
Ken Bond's props. He was excellent.
He was very good.
Someone who was having to carry out his duty regardless of his own personal feeling until we got to the point where basically they were throwing down their guns and just sort of step over. He was superb, man.
How many lives did we give you? I've got all night.
That was cool.
I was going to ask that. Is there a possibility he might have now unlimited regenerations?
No. A cycle was mentioned, so unless it gets retconned later, a cycle it is.
Rassilon said, "How many regenerations did we give you?" Didn't they say? It's unlimited. Okay, who'd have said?
Because only Rassilon's got unlimited.
We'll worry about that when we get to the 25th or 26th, Doctor, however.
Yeah.
Maybe the intention was to throw that rule out the window.
Here's the thing. The Doctor is the only one who said new regeneration cycle, and how would he know if he only got one or got 10 or got half of one?
Yeah. He killed the moon, he actually asked that question.
He wouldn't know.
He said a whole new regeneration cycle.
Mm. Yeah, that's what he assumes he's got. Maybe they're going to give him only half of that amount, and he's thinking he's got a whole lot.
He asked that question. How many regenerations do I have?
Time lords didn't see what he regenerated into, conceivably, so they don't know which number he's on when they meet.
Exactly.
Good point.
Yeah, the Time Lords give, and the Time Lords...
Exactly, they just pump it through the crack and see what comes back.
But in the Five Doctors, it is established that only Rassilon's got it, right? He's got perpetual regeneration.
Yeah.
He's immortal. Well, they never said the word only. They simply said that he had perpetual regeneration.
Yeah. And Barusa wanted some of that.
Well, that glove was a bit crap this week, wasn't it? Yeah,
that was obviously a different prop. It was, you could actually see it was just the thing that fit over his hand. It wasn't even.
Yeah, it wasn't the original.
It wasn't a gauntlet, was it? Yeah.
Well, Dalton's was made of
man. It's a half trillion years it's going flat.
Not to fit him, and they may have had to make a secondary prop.
Well, that or it got damaged in the fight against the Master.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, maybe right after he regenerated into her. Well, that's a tongue twister, isn't it? Then turned around and bitch slapped Rassilon and broke the glove.
Yeah, but for Amradlon, why the hell would you regenerate yourself into an old man's body if you want to remain
a big man? Regenerate to an old man. It's a lot of years that's passed by. So he probably got old.
You don't know how many he's gone through in those points.
Yeah, that's true.
You got Tim Dillon.
That could have been the very same incarnation, just, you know, a few thousand years later.
Yep. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, okay.
The one thing that did interest me, to be honest with you as well, is that everyone is, you know, really scared of the sliders that, what they call them, the race and everything like that. But on all accounts, they spoke to him. Yeah, for some reason, they saw the Doctor as something special and they spoke to him. They imparted knowledge. Now, whether there's some sort of echo from,
Omega.
Exactly. To be honest with you, they are a very interesting development, to be honest with you. I hope to see something of that more.
Nah, you can forget Omega. He's going to be too busy fighting K-9 in
2017. Why did the Doctor shoot the General?
To get rid of him.
Distraction. Big thing to escape. It was just a ploy.
Biggest threat in the room. Biggest threat in the room. The other ones are scientists.
If you face with several people against you, you smack a harmless bastard as hard as you can. You pretty much the game. When you mail this, you'll be getting the same.
It's prison rules. You go take on the biggest guy in the wing.
Yeah. Biggest dog in the yard. Yeah.
And here's the thing. Who knows if the others in that room were actually Time Lords and had regenerations?
Mm. Oh, they would have been.
They would have been.
Anybody that lives in the capital are Time Lords.
Yeah, the Chancellor Guard always have regenerations.
Didn't help Maxwell, did it? He's a big fair chicken.
They didn't really look like soldiers.
So regular citizens aren't allowed in the capital?
No. It's
no.
The renegades, they're the ones who left the capital.
The Shabogans.
That's right. Mm.
He told that kid to go to the capital.
Yeah, I was just waiting for Malcolm Reynolds to show up in that crowd. One-liners.
In Doom Coalition, they solidify that Lady Romana let foreigners from other planets study in the capital.
Yeah.
So I wonder if some of them are in there somewhere.
that would explain the Amish, refugee look.
I did not like that look. I did not like that part. See those people.
I get that. That's all of technology, and then
meanwhile, and welcome to another enthralling episode of Finnapartia Fashion Police. Yeah.
But no, but I mean, it just didn't fit Gallifrey. That kind of dress sense. It's like
they're the outsiders.
Yeah, but the outsiders look like Native Americans in Invasion of Time.
Next,
you want everybody? You want them to dress like Zardoz, man.
Next on Philip Archer's fashion show, Time Lord hats and how do they stay on your head?
But yeah, Dr. Frieden made a very good point. It is the sort of Clint Eastwood type thing as well. You know, he's even the jacket, to be honest with you, the jacket is sort of very, if you have
Daddy that, the
minister type thing, to be honest with you. They held him in some sort of reverence. They all gathered round and sat him. Yeah, watch him sit there and go to have the soup and everything like that.
One thing he does
fantastically is the throwaway looks and the throwaway comments. So he sort of like picks it up and he's sort of like,
I actually love that.
Yeah, for soup.
I actually love that, but they're watching him on the monitor and Rassilon's all agitated and fidgety. Oh, what's his plan? Oh, Helia, I think he's finishing his soup.
Although I do love when he's like, talking to them and like he disses their hats, yet not one of them in that room was wearing a hat. There was no actual Time Lord wearing a hat in that room. But no one's there to hear your quip against the hat.
Well, there was another scene that was kind of screwed up a little bit too, when at the end where he's talking to Clara and me isn't standing there in the scene. And they show the whole room and she's not in the room again. It's like, dude, where'd you go? You know, so that was kind of because she was just there. She walked in with the doctor, and then all of a sudden she's not there. So there was a couple of little mistakes.
Hey, that happens though. But I think they had to really work around her schedule or something, because there's a couple of scenes like that in Face the Raven where you don't think she's really there. She did her part in front of a green screen.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's just probably some kind of technical thing that you weren't supposed to know.
Let's put the cat amongst the pigeons. How do you guys all feel that, you know, you've got to the end of the universe, all the stars are burning out, everything's dying. In essence, the Time Lords have gone. You know, she's there in the remnants of the Cloister era and everything like that. You see the giant glow of all the stars and all the moons and suns burning out far away in the distance. It's beautiful, whatever. And the only one that's left is Shilda or me. She has, in essence, outlived the Time Lord. She's outlived everyone. She's gone beyond the boundaries of Earth. She's gone out, you know, with the human race, I suppose, at whatever was it, 2140, everything like that. Gone out to the stars, and she's reached the point of Gallifrey. She's there at the very end.
Yeah.
Do you think it's fair that she has outlived the Time Lords as a race and everything like that?
Well, I always thought that that thing that got into her was only a limited lifespan. But I didn't think
it's perpetual repairing.
Yep, forever repairing her.
Yeah, but
yeah.
Come die with me.
I quite liked it, but the only thing that I was confused about is clothes degrade over time. They're not immortal as me is. So who made her clothes at the end of the universe?
Big 80s hair obviously made a comeback at the end of the world.
I'll put it this way. I mean,
it's the same people that mow the lawn in The Walking Dead, and you will never see them.
Yeah, you know. I doubt there was a JCPenney's at the end of the universe, so I dare say she's run out of soul, surely, after all that.
I love the chessboard. That was a nice little touch.
Yeah,
she had company with her or was expecting the doctor's company, because there were two chairs there.
Yep.
Well, O'Hilla said, what's it, the end of the world you expect? What's it called? She said the
Company of Immortals.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Did that. There is one question. You know how we know that now that Clara and me are now off in their own TARDIS in a way? Surely the Time Lord can track that.
There you go. That's a 9 p.m. spinoff, folks.
Yep, that's going to be one of theirs after 9 p.m.
I'd watch it.
Time and space.
Quantum Queef.
Well, there you go.
Oh, my God.
We do know that
But Clara's at least shown some interest in a female before.
She is a former school teacher.
Jane Austen.
I even had an intro done up for this one. I was going to like, she is a former school teacher. She is a former young Viking maiden from the 6th century. And now both immortal. They have gotten a TARDIS. And they now travel through time. They are time sluts.
There you go. For Captain Jack. That could be the name of their first movie. The motion picture could be called, wait for it, The Search for Captain Jack. I need to drop some children off at the pool.
It
gives a whole new meaning to the term Torchwood.
That's on the Wrath of Khan.
Hang on. Don't all TARDISes have recall circuits? So can't the time just simply recall that TARDIS if they want to try and catch Clara again?
Why would they? That, you know, this leaves a great return for both of the characters to show up anywhere in the future.
They did pull that one off the repair line.
I would certainly agree with Anthony. It's a superb sort of like, you know, open door policy, to be honest. For who comes after.
If the Doctor runs into them, though, he's not going to know who Clara is, though.
Just remember the description given to about the Raven. That you can like run and hide from it all you want, but it's going to eventually come.
She's going to go back to that exact spot where she dies.
She's going to take a long trip going there. That's it.
Yep. Yeah.
All the way around.
You know, kind of like Tennant, he wouldn't go and die quickly, would he? So,
I know. I always got to
lie, baby doctor.
I didn't know you could hold a regeneration in like a really, really bad crap you got to take. You know, I don't know.
My wife described it.
As long as sometime in the future she goes back to that point, then it won't unravel the web of time. But what the doctor was doing is trying to avoid that, which would have caused the web of time to unravel. But in her case, she does plan on going back to there, but it could be a million years from now.
Does that mean that point
is really tying up her climate load?
Yeah.
So then, if that's the case,
she can go back there at any time, as long as she goes back.
If that's the point, what's keeping the web of time from cracking then? If you can hold off on it for so long,
What had happened was, if the doctor had successfully averted her death completely, it would have been unraveling at that point. It would have, I don't want to look for too many explanations in it, because
as long as she has intent, then everything is intact.
But
he saved the Bowie base people, but you know,
AJ.
Okay.
AJ. I was gonna say, if Clara erased his memory of her completely, does that mean she also erased the memory of him being back on Gallifrey and finding it?
No, he said, remember, he went back later and he said, you can notice something's wrong by the hole it leaves, basically.
It's very much a Star Wars thing, Joe. I mean, there's a void there and you can sort of start to put the pieces together based by what he's missing.
He did mention to her that he did remember, you know, this person, you know, he didn't remember exactly details, but he knows he went to a Russian sub and met an ice warrior with somebody. Then he goes a little bit more detail. So he does know something happened during that time. And so he has an idea of the event.
It's just a blank there. Okay.
He doesn't know who. Weird. Yeah.
Yeah, because her picture is forgotten. You first take this time.
I was just saying her picture is painted on the TARDIS, and he looks at. He doesn't even recognize that it's her. You know, he just gets there and takes it. So.
Yeah, who's this, hey man? Who's painting chicks on my TARDIS, man?
I like how
Sonic.
I like it.
It's a nice little probe.
You went there.
Yeah, I like it. Thorpe will need to be a bit bigger than that, though.
Okay.
It's not about the size, it's what you do with it, son.
It's not encoded, yes. Yeah.
It looked lovely. I mean, and as it says in one of those little info snippets, he says that it's in the shape of the TARDIS console, if you look at it properly.
There you go.
Well, oh, really? If you think about it, Moffat gave Clara, or excuse me, Moffat gave the Doctor, a perfect happy ending. He gets to forget Clara. I'm not that lucky.
Oh.
Well, see, that's if we can go back to that picture real quick, if you look at it, can we go back to that picture real quick? I want to point something out. Look at the mechanism in between the two gold lines. Right there. That looks like a trigger that releases those two clamps on the side. That may extend out.
It does extend out.
So,
although it looks rather uncomfortable to hold.
Mm. Yeah, I can see what you're saying there. We didn't put a bit on the side, man. But I do like it.
Hang on. Don't worry about it, man. Philip can handle it.
If you look at the egg beater part at the back, that looks like that compresses and the back extends as well.
Mm. Yeah, possibly.
There you go.
We'll find out when he uses it.
How many years is it going to take to get a good version of the toy, I wonder?
I just wanted to find the little dimension inside of the console that has a bunch of Keebler elves constantly hammering out new
Sonics.
For God's sake, can you not keep the Sonic for more than 10 minutes? It costs money to make things, you know.
Would we like to see Capaldi change his desk got to the that old style TARDIS?
No.
He can't afford it. He can't do it.
That console was in the Doctor Who experience. In order to film that scene, I think they had to shut down the experience for like 12 hours.
I'm happy with that little glimpse I got. Do you know what I mean?
They can rebuild that set in the studio. Easy, man. So I don't know why.
Why would they? That was then. This is now. It's a different.
They got bigger and better every time.
Living in the past, aren't you, dude?
Yeah, I love the set they have now.
But I don't like that big thing at the top that goes round and round.
It's a nice blending of the old and the new, to be honest with you. A little touch of everything in between. Do you know what I mean? It's like, everything jumped in, shaken about, and it comes out and it's not that unpleasant on the eye. Mm. One thing I did come away with it, I know it's still going to split a lot of people, the fact is that there's one TARDIS, there's two TARDISes now floating about, one with the Doctor, one with me and Clara in it. But the one thing it did sort of leave it was, it harks back to something that he said earlier in the season, do you know what I mean? When they're both about being reckless, there's only space enough in this TARDIS for one person, and that's me. That's perfect fulfillment of something that was said earlier in the season. There are some really very clever
that too, and Clara's wish to be the Doctor, now she is. She's got her own TARDIS now, she's got her own, she just has a deadline she has to meet at some point, but she can do what she wants, and she's got her own companion now, apparently, so it's pretty much
that's true. Actually,
what they were painting her out to be for 2 years now is the Doctor wannabe. That's not. There's nothing wrong with that.
She'd be the patron saint.
Like, I made a good Doctor, didn't I? Yeah. He's like, no, you didn't. I mean, so it's kind of a wishful fulfillment on her part in a way.
Fast forward, how many worlds are like? Oh, we could have had the Doctor, but this bimbo showed up.
There's two sets of boobs that are coming with this.
Exactly. Let me close the silver lining, though.
Exactly. Silver lining.
Well, I like to think that not every alien world out there looks at humans and goes, oh, wow.
I think it was an effective way to write the character out, because at the end of the day, you're not going to see her again. She won't be back next year. And it was a reversal of the Donna approach, because everybody was sad when what happened to Donna. That wasn't, everybody's like, oh, that's not cool. That sucks.
Yeah, but that was, they handled that better than what they've done here. They should have left her off at Face of Raven. That should have been it for her.
Exactly.
I agree
with that wholeheartedly. But then, you also have to look at the other happy side of things. Since they've gone and they've flown off, remember, she has to meet her deadline. But what happens if their TARDIS, so I don't know, materializes into a supernova and they get blown to pieces and she can't make her deadline?
What cancels it out?
Doctor has to fix everything.
The time loans would fix it.
Yeah.
I did that already with Charlie Pollard, so.
Yeah.
TARDIS is a pretty automatic right now, and they don't really crash into supernovas. They pretty much manage to avoid them pretty easily. But only thing could happen to her, you're like Bill. Only action could happen to her, she lands up dead, which would f*** thing up.
Oh, really?
No, because if she dies, it's the same thing. In other words, the unraveling of the universe wouldn't happen anyway, because she's already dead. So.
Yeah, she's still meets her death anyway.
If the Doctor had succeeded in saving Clara, surely the Raven would still come for her. Because the description given is, you can run and hide wherever you want, but it will come for you in the end.
No, but that point of time is frozen.
Yeah.
No, but if you had taken her from there and saved her, and didn't take her back,
Ryan, that point remains frozen until she's put back in.
Yeah.
Wibbly wobbly timey wimey.
Yeah.
That just completely ruins the whole thing, really. Like, she could have just, like, there would have been no purpose because it.
At the end, she's not going to age. She's not going to change because her heartbeat is, in essence, she's static. She's.
Yeah.
You know, she just, like, in essence, she's Kim Cattrall from. No, I prefer the Kim Cattrall from Mannequin. She will never age, she will never change and everything like that, as long as at some point she thinks, there's somewhere I've got to be. It doesn't have to be any some place, point or time. Yeah.
Or maybe the Kim Cattrall from Big Trouble in Little China. She was still kind of hot.
The girl with green jade eyes.
Exactly, yeah.
Why would time unravel if she didn't go back?
Because her death was a fixed point in the space-time continuum. No, I know, trust me, I'm still trying to figure out why it didn't unravel because of the Bowie base crew, but like I said, that's just the technicality. I ain't going to fool around.
I mean, it was an effective way to get rid of the character with a kind of a happy ending for both sides without making it like it was last time where the Doctor's going to mope around on a cloud or whatever. It's
been a character-driven ending as opposed to a event.
Yeah, I mean, what they did last year would have worked, last Christmas, that would have worked if that was her departure. She just, you know, lived her life without the Doctor, and she was an old woman now. That would have worked, but I mean, in other words, since she decided to stay on for one more year, they had to figure out some other way to get rid of, you know, somebody that's supposed to be like a very important companion for the Doctor. And to be fair. It must be hard at this point to come away with effective ways for characters to leave because, you know, you could kill them off, but that'd just be brutal. And then, you know, like, I mean, the way they did it with the previous ones, at least in the new series, was okay. You know, you leave Rose in a parallel universe. Martha leaves on her own. That was the best way. You know what? I'm done with you. I'm out. And then Donna was tragic. And then Amy Pond was supposedly tragic for the Doctor, but, you know, to be fair, she got to live out her life with her husband in the past. So, I mean, the question is, when you're trying to write out a companion, what's a good way to do it that's new and different?
True.
If, you know, if they want to do the marrying off like Joe Grant, you know, that would work for her, but not it would get old, wouldn't it? So.
Yeah.
I might step on some toes here, but I think my favorite companion leaving is Tegan Javanka. She just looks at what the Doctor is and is just like, I can't do this anymore, man.
That is a good leaving.
I think that my favorite character departure was Adric.
Well, there you go. Yeah.
No, I was just thinking that earlier today. Just imagine Matthew Waterhouse watches this episode. What the hell? Why did he come out and say me, the bastard?
Just no one likes you, Adric.
Yeah, I'll tell you where to shove that badge of mathematical excellence.
Oh, man.
And it's not into a Cyberman's chest unit.
The question is, does Matthew Waterhouse like Adric?
It's a good question.
If so, he'd be the only one.
Holy fee.
Well, standing by. I feel like I'm the only person who likes Adric in the whole world.
Philip likes him too.
For different reasons.
Because he was just a kid.
Oh. All right, Val, steady on.
Ooh, we're onto the trailer. Really? Okay.
Yeah, we'll reuse that trap seat set. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I help you?
Yes, are you the surgeon?
Close enough, why?
There's a medical emergency.
Do I know you?
You most certainly do not. My husband is dying.
That's your husband.
Is there a problem?
Destroy them! I don't like
it. Here we go.
So basically, River Song's having sex with Big Hero 6.
Yeah. Or Giant Robo, huh?
River, that's not the one they showed after the episode, is it?
And her vagina is not compatible. Yeah,
that was that trailer, when I finished watching the episode, they didn't show that trailer.
No, they showed two. They showed two.
There were two, yeah.
Was his head on a mock TARDIS console?
No, it was. His head attaches to that robot.
It's like a little plate type thing, if you remember.
Yeah. Right, there's like that. One scene where it looked like it was resting on the TARDIS console.
Yeah, it was.
It's like a detachable sort of conduit, like plate type crap. Mm.
Think.
Hey, I'm all about techniques.
Okay, hang on, Anthony has to leave us. Let's go ahead and let him give a rating and then head on out.
Okay.
Well, let me see if I. Okay, I got it off my mute. I'd like to give it this episode probably an 8 out of 10. I really did actually enjoy it. Yeah, I know, Doc. I know. It's a shock coming from me. I did really enjoy it. I did like how they left it, you know, regardless of whether she didn't die, which is kind of heartbreaking to me. She should have died. But at least they left it open with maybe not a happy ending. They just postponed her death. So, and they leave it wide open for both characters to come back. I really did enjoy me as a character this season. So, that's my final thoughts on it.
I like that. That is a very excellent way to put it. It's not that she died. It's just been postponed.
There you go.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, guys.
See you, man.
See you later.
Take care, man.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, we've been ranting and carrying on for over an hour now. Let's go ahead and let's rate this sucker and put it.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's start with. All right. Oh, heck. I was going to say. All right, Matt, are you there?
Is he alive?
Is there anybody out there?
Did you hear me
clip? Not for West, not for
Moon. Why does he even come in? He's never here at the end.
I'm trying to figure out if he's even
it's
here.
It's because he's full of charisma.
Yeah. he's not connected anymore.
Matt, let's move on to Texas Sam. What do you give this one out of 10?
I've only seen it the one time, so I'm gonna want to watch it again. But at this point, I gave it a 10, and I really enjoyed it. Thought it was great.
This episode,
I thought it was. I liked
it. We're giving it an numeric rating.
Shut up.
I thought it was a great ending to a pretty good series. I mean, I think, I at this point, I give it a 10. I'm going to watch it again tomorrow, but I'll, you know, right now I'm really impressed with what we got. I think it tied up all the loose ends, all the plot threads, the ongoing bits, and it worked really well. It was a good ending. Can't wait for Christmas.
Okay, Ryan.
Because the finale is a three-parter, I'd say this is... I still am trying to decide if I like this or Face the Raven more. I'm going to give it a 9. It was a really strong story. What they did with Clara and her departure was unique, and that really sums up this whole season. Really unique lot of episodes, and Capaldi is just fantastic in this role. I hope he stays in it for a long time after this.
All right, Kevin.
Ten out of 10. I really loved it.
All right, Bill.
I actually put this one down just a little bit, and I think it's not that I didn't like the episode, but I think that I really still expected a bit more with Gallifrey. Still really good. I gave the last one a 10. I'm giving this one a 9. And Steve, what number did you give it out of 10?
For this season, I give it a 10. Overall, I give it an 8. I love Capaldi to death. He is amazing. They're just not giving the stories he deserves.
All right. All right, William.
I give this specific episode, I'm giving it an 8 out of 10. But this whole season, I'm going to give it a 10. And Capaldi has been great this whole season. That's why I'm tired of hearing people complaining about it. Yeah. They don't know squat.
Also, 10 out of 10 for me for the whole season.
The whole season. Yeah, where I'm thinking about doing a series. Okay, Beefhead.
This was a tough one because, like I say, I watched it back, and then I went back and I watched the ending, and then I watched the start again and let it run through to the end. And I was trying to work out whether I liked it or I didn't like it. Give me a second, Andrew. So it was tough. The music was extremely effective. Capaldi's guitar was superb. You know, the harking back, even to be honest with you, referring all the way back to Name of the Doctor, you know, kindly and cowardly and everything like that, you know, never be this and everything like that. It was a superb harking backs to things gone past. The acting of the people, I cannot fault. Like I say, apart from the principals, you know, Ken Bones as the general was absolutely superb. If I had to lay a fault with anything of it, it was probably the writing, because I think as fans we can follow along with it, but for a casual viewer, it's a bit of a mishmash and everything like that. But I do also like event endings. I like character driven stuff, but I also like event things. And when you get to the end of the series, hey, I want big explosions and, you know, shit happening and everything like that. But I came away with it. I did like it. I did like it. Don't get me wrong. I did like it. So I'm going to give it a 7.5. I'm flitting between the 7.5 and an 8 for me. Yeah. Well, it was solid. No, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it as a 7.5 and an 8, but it's sort of like I like it and I really want to like it more, but I think it's not all the pieces at the end of it come together to a certain degree. I think to be honest with you, it's not the end, it's not the beginning, it's the middle that screws it up, because it's not fully formed, and that is a writing thing. It's not a directorial thing, it's not an acting thing, it's a writing thing. The middle loses it a little bit. It comes back at the end, it starts off well, but the middle falls down a bit. So that's what I'm going to say. I'll say an 8. I'll be generous. 8.
Okay, Andrew, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I would like to say I really enjoyed this episode, and I give it a 10 out of 10.
All right, Graham.
On one view and only, as I say, music superb. As Beef's alluded to the actors, oh, brilliant. I'll give it a 9.
All right, AJ.
Yeah, I'm going to give this one a 10 out of 10. I think it was just a top story. Perfect end for the season.
All right, Floyd.
Graham.
Sorry. That was me, yeah? I thought I heard Graham. Yeah. Sorry. I really like this story. I don't want to be the fashion police, but I think the outsiders definitely...
Don't worry, Phil will do that.
I definitely think the outsiders shouldn't have been dressed as the Amish. I don't know what that was about. It's found a little weird, because how do they have human clothes? But other than that, I really enjoyed this episode. So 9 out of 10 for me.
Okay, Edgar.
Well, it's Christmas, so I ain't going to go totally Scrooge. You know, I've said what I've said. As a trilogy, it was pretty good. Altogether, all three parts, I'd probably give it an 8. But for this particular episode, it didn't work for me. I'm going to give it a 6.5.
It's Christmas in 20 days. You don't have to do that.
That's okay. All right, Callan.
Yeah. And I thought the starting was a bit slow. Nice touches. Pretty good. I'll give it an 8.
All right, and Philip?
I wasn't quite sure what to give this as a rating, but I'm gonna go with everybody else and say I'll give it an 8, purely because some of it was okay, the majority of it was okay. I just wish that they didn't extend the Clara thing to the point of what they'd done. They should have left her out, face the Raven. But otherwise, it's a good story. So it's an 8 for me as well.
Okay, now when I initially viewed this and I saw the ending and all that, I was like, oh, great. Moffat's pulled the chicken switch again. But at the same time, there's going to be a number of fans out there who are going to enjoy it, see it as magical, touchable, touches them. And so I can't really stomp down on it. So I'm going to drop this one in at a 9.
I don't want to say that they're playing it safe, but it kind of comes across that way, that they were almost too afraid to fully kill her off. Kind of like how they were afraid to do the whole half-human thing, because I think that's what that comes down to.
Well, I'm happy with what they did. They implied it, but they didn't actually say it.
Yeah.
So that leaves it still wide open, you know.
They sealed the envelope for it to start afresh next year. That's one thing it does do.
Yeah, because we're gonna see, you know, the whole half human debate start again everywhere from Facebook, Twitter to Gallifrey Base again. So
what's up with that, by the way?
But let's say if they were to say that the Doctor was half human, it would be better than that explanation they gave in the comics or whatever it was.
It
was like a ploy to deceive the Master. Because how would that deceive the Master in any way, shape, or form?
Well, a lot of the people now who watch the show won't read the comics. So,
at the end of the day, just like the whole gender swap on TV tonight, it doesn't matter. Move on.
Also, you know, we got a lot of stuff to look forward to. We got the Christmas special coming up. We got the War Doctor series coming out on Vic.
Yes.
My way, Phil. My way. Yeah.
You can wait. You can wait, bitch. I'll send it to you when I'm ready.
And if you haven't listened to Jago and Lightfoot and Strax yet, please do it. It is freaking hilarious. That was brilliant. I know. Big Briggs, send me money. Okay. But as I can't plug those guys enough at Big Finish. They always have something somebody out there loves, and that's what I love about them. Okay, let's get goodbyes from everybody real quick. Well, Matt, I'm assuming you're saying goodbye. Sorry you couldn't join us.
In the way he goes.
Like I said, maybe, I don't know. The problem is it's going to be a while because, like I said, Lady G's surgeries this week. Maybe I can get together with Matt. We'll record something later, and we'll do a little review for you, so that way he gets a chance to get his two cents later.
If you try and get Lady New in as well, if you can, because
I have no idea when we're going to be able to do it because, like I said, her surgery is this week, and she's going to be laid up for a while. And, it's just I really can't schedule anything definite right now at this point. So, okay, let's get goodbyes from everybody. As I said before, let's go ahead. Let's Texas Tim.
Wasn't hooked up to anything. It was not
formatted. As always, thanks for having me. I enjoyed discussing this episode with you people, and I can't wait till Christmas.
All right, Ryan.
Thank you for having me. It's been a wonderful journey on this season. Possibly the best season we've had since the show's revival. I've had fun discussing all of these episodes with all of you, and bring on Christmas.
I told you, a year ago, I saw
somebody talking about that again.
Hold on. I can't let that go on because it's going to blot out anybody when the recording goes through. So,
for you.
Who are you?
If someone is in the mic.
Okay.
Let's get the Ville here so he can mute his mic in a second.
So, what's everyone else planning on doing until Christmas? I am not happy about what's coming up, so I don't know if I'm going to watch this. It's got River in it. River was a good character for her run, but now it's a dead horse and they need to stop beating her.
That's not going to happen. She comes and she got her own Big Finish in January.
Yeah.
It's Christmas and River's between companions. You got to do something.
Yeah, that's another thing. Yeah, River Song. She's going to have the Diary of River Song. She's also going to be in Doom Coalition 2.
They could have simply just incorporated a new companion into the Christmas episode and carry on from there.
No. Stop begging, you'll just wait till next season.
No, Jesus, you're so demanding, Philip.
I know, Philip.
No. The reason why they're doing that is because
I'm wondering what the hell are they thinking? I mean, they've
really the reason why they do this is because technically the Christmas special is not a part of Series 9 or Series 10. It's kind of like a standalone. So they just brought her in for this one. See, that's why, because I don't think they've even casted anybody yet.
I don't think they have.
We don't know when they're coming back.
They're at shortlist stage.
Yeah, they do have a short list, but they have not cast anyone definitely as yet. Okay, Kevin.
I thought that was already filmed.
Huh? What?
Thanks for having me for this whole series. I enjoyed it. And, yeah, good night, guys.
No, no, they have not filmed Series 10 yet, Bill.
It's not even started yet, no.
They haven't even started filming it yet. We have no idea when they're going to start filming it, by the way. Okay, William.
Thank you for having me here, and hope to be here for the Christmas story.
Okay, Beefhead.
Wow. There's been 14 of us in a room talking about this last season finisher, and we haven't killed each other. I think in itself, that's an achievement in itself. I've had
a blast. Not yet.
Yeah, I've had a blast talking to you all about it. You know, I think it's been consistently good, to be honest with you, this season gone by. I'm sure we'll do a review in the lead up to Christmas of what's gone on before. You know, we had one definite clunker, from my point of view. I'm content. The state of who is in a good state of play to start afresh next year. That's, if we can walk away and just say, look, we're in a good position to go forward from it, then it's done its job. So, yeah. Fantastic.
Okay, Edgar.
Thank you for allowing me in this season. And I'm really looking forward for the future. Unfortunately, I will not be able to do Christmas with y'all. Pretty much most of the end of December, I'm not going to be around. So hopefully I can get back with y'all next year. Thank you, man.
Looking forward to having you back on when you're available, man. Okay, Philip.
Why can't you be here?
Thank you for having me. It's been a good season. It's cemented Capaldi for me for this year. Last year he wasn't my doctor, but this year I think he's becoming my doctor. And I look forward to seeing you at Christmas when I am one of River's husbands.
Okay, fingers crossed when he was laying on the floor.
Okay, Floyd.
Thank you for letting me on for the finale. I know I haven't been here for this season, I apologize, but this has been great. A good finale, solid series, and the series as a whole is definitely, it's a 9 for me. This is so good. It's been great. Thank you for having me.
Okay, AJ.
Thanks for having me, guys, and I will catch you when are we filming that?
Oh, no, Christmas special, yeah, we won't be doing the Omega Files on that till the 26th.
Okay, I'll so the 27th.
Okay. Hey, we're getting some feedback from somebody, are we? All right, maybe it was Graham. Graham,
Drinky again.
Graham, what have we told you? You can keep the Loch Ness Monster in your basement, but you have to keep it quiet.
What about the next week, Freedom?
Same with you and your dingo.
Next week. No, next week we're on hiatus.
Tazzy. Okay.
Cool.
Okay, and of course, Graham.
Well, Christmas is coming. I'm off to get drunk. Cry me a river.
Gallon.
Yep. Thanks for having me, gentlemen, and good night.
And Andrew.
Yeah, thanks for having me. And spot whales in the US next summer. Come on back. Goodbye.
Okay, well, folks, on behalf of myself and the rest of the panel, and have a Merry Christmas, and we'll see you all for the Christmas special review. So,
yeah!
We'll be waiting for you.
Wilbur!
Have to go get down now!